This is Ken Anderson, and I'm thrilled to welcome you again this year for our update on myeloma, including the most recent data from American Society of Hematology, or ASH. Here are my disclosures. I always like to start with this and remind everybody of the amazing progress that's happened in the last 20 years with the proteasome inhibitors, the immunomodulatory drugs, monoclonal antibodies. We have a nuclear transport inhibitor, an immunotoxin, and now we have approved CAR T cells. At the bottom of this slide, it's 29 FDA approvals, and many people now have myeloma as a chronic illness. Now, in addition to or related to all of these advances is a wonderful outcome shown on this slide. This is called minimal residual disease. So after treatment, you can have as few as 1 in 100,000 or 1 in 1,000,000 normal myeloma cell in normal bone marrow. And on the left-hand side is progression-free survival, time without active myeloma. On the right is overall survival. And the different colors are newly diagnosed patients with myeloma who are either transplant eligible or not, or patients who have refractory disease. And the whole point of this slide is you can now achieve these unprecedented extents of response using novel treatments from the last slide. And they make a difference in terms of how long you live without any active myeloma and how long you live overall. So major progress. So those of you who are transplant candidates, this is for newly diagnosed transplant candidates. These slides, by the way, will be available, and I'm not going to go over all the detail, but I will remind you or mention this year that lenalidomide bortezomib dexamethasone, we call it RVD, as many of you know, has been improved upon by adding daratumumab. That's in the red in the middle of this slide. What is the improvement? There's many higher percentages of MRD, minimal residual disease negative responses. And it turns out that makes a difference. So firstly, if you just use RVD, lenalidomide bortezomib dexamethasone transplant and maintenance, this slide shows you that in standard risk multiple myeloma, the time without active disease is 76 months. And at 140 months, the overall survival still has not been, median overall survival has still not been reached. What this means is that in the context of standard risk myeloma, RVD has turned the disease into a chronic illness for many patients. I mentioned that daratumumab was added to RVD in an attempt to improve it in the Griffin trial. So here we have daratumumab, RVD before and after transplant, and daratumumab Revlimid maintenance compared in a randomized trial with RVD before and after transplant and Revlimid maintenance. And I just have the one slide here to show you, which is to say on the left-hand side that if you add daratumumab to RVD and you go top to bottom of that column, the MRD negative percentage increases up to 81% as you go from the RVD DARA before transplant and the RVD DARA and the maintenance. It's almost everybody now getting that fewer than 1 in 100,000 myeloma in normal bone marrow cells. And I showed you earlier that it does make a difference in your outcome. Now at the American Society of Hematology, the other CD38 antibody besides daratumumab is called isatuximab, and it was added to RVD before and after transplant and compared to RVD before and after transplant. And just very analogous to the Griffin trial, except this is isatuximab, another CD38 antibody instead of daratumumab. And I put it in here, just one slide, but those patients who got the isatuximab along with RVD did better, whether they were old, whether they had high risk disease, et cetera. So adding a CD38 antibody to RVD is now becoming a standard of care. Now, other studies that were presented at ASH is the same as RVD, except in this example, carfilzomib, the stronger proteasome inhibitor, was added to Revlimid Dex and daratumumab. So it's called DARA-KRD. Same thing going across the slide here, used before transplant, transplant used as consolidation, and ultimately maintenance. But the point of this slide is not the detail, but there was an opportunity to stop treatment in patients who had MRD negativity. And this is the future, getting to MRD negative status, and then you'll see what's called discontinuation trials. Is it safe to stop lenalidomide maintenance or consolidation in this particular slide? So this really is the future. This is the conclusion of that particular study. Again, unprecedented responses, and MRD now in clinical trials is being used to inform treatment. Should I get maintenance or not, et cetera. Now, if you are a newly diagnosed patient but not transplant eligible, you also enjoy the benefits of these new drugs. Lenalidomide, bortezomib dex, or RVD, has attenuated doses, and it's called RVD light, as many of you know. Very commonly, though, daratumumab is now becoming a standard of care for newly diagnosed non-transplant patients as well, based on the daratumumab Lendex, or the so-called MAIA trial. And that's shown on this particular slide. On the left-hand side is daratumumab lenalidomide dex with versus lenalidomide dex. And you can see the percentage response and the extent of response is higher when daratumumab is added to Lendex. There's more MRD negative responses as shown on the right when daratumumab Lendex is used compared to Lendex. And it turns out the progression-free survival is markedly prolonged. It hasn't been reached versus 34 months with Lendex. So this is very exciting indeed. And so the CD38 antibody used initially can also benefit non-transplant patients. Now, this slide is just a menu of the different regimens that you can use. RVD light is included there. So is the MAIA trial I just mentioned to you, DARA-RD versus RD. But the point is not the detail. The point is, in fact, that even non-transplant patient ineligible patients are benefiting tremendously by novel treatments. And in this particular ASH with the use of daratumumab in conjunction with lenalidomide dexamethasone. Now, some of you may have myeloma that has had the nerve to return and be called relapsed refractory myeloma in spite of those nice initial treatments. And when we sit in the clinic or we have Zooms like this, we talk about different factors that can make it possible to pick the best treatment for each and every one of you. Frailty, are you fit or frail? What about other situations or morbidities, kidney failure, neuropathy? What's the genetic risk? But probably most importantly are the last two on the right here. What is the prior treatment and what is the goal of therapy in terms of your life? We have a variety of options from which to choose. And again, these slides will be available and can be used as a resource as you would like. But in the case where myeloma is refractory to bortezomib, we have a variety of lenalidomide dexamethasone-based triplets. In the situation where we have lenalidomide refractory myeloma, we have a number of bortezomib dex-related triplets. At the top of the slide, in lenalidomide and bortezomib refractory myeloma, which is would be most common in the US, we have a variety of regimens shown there. And then at the bottom of the slide, even in far advanced myeloma, we still have choices. This is so-called triple class refractory when your myeloma doesn't respond to the IMIDs anymore or the proteasome inhibitors or CD38 antibody. We still have selinexor, belantamab, mafodotin, and CAR T cells, all FDA approved. So again, this is just to make the point, in patients whose myeloma is lenalidomide refractory, what this slide shows is that Velcade Dex has been compared with Velcade Dex pomalidomide, Velcade Dex daratumumab, Velcade Dex selinexor, and even Velcade Dex venetoclax. And in the red box, what that shows is that you have a much better chance of longer time without myeloma if one of these triplets is used. This is the converse. If the myeloma that you have has been treated and is refractory to bortezomib, then we have these lenalidomide dex-based regimens. Lendex has been combined with the oral proteasome inhibitor exazimib, the antibody elotuzumab, the proteasome inhibitor carfilzomib, or the antibody daratumumab. And in each case, the triplet treatment has proved to prolong progression-free survival. And then this is a complicated slide, but I'll make it very simple. If the myeloma is resistant to both lenalidomide and bortezomib, then we have the second generation IMiD called pomalidomide and the second generation proteasome inhibitor called carfilzomib, which serve as the backbone for a variety of combinations. On the left-hand side of this slide, pomalidomide dex has been compared with pomalidomide dex and the antibody elotuzumab, with the antibody isatuximab, and with the antibody daratumumab. All of those regimens are FDA approved because the triplet was superior in terms of achieving time without active myeloma. On the right-hand side are the basic studies with carfilzomib dex as the backbone, to which has been added daratumumab, or the other CD38 antibody isatuximab. And in each, both of these are FDA approved because the triplet treatment works. The summary is that regardless of what your myeloma is refractory to, we have many options now regularly available and approved. Now, during the pandemic, I want to just mention a couple of advances here. Selinexor, the nuclear transport inhibitor, was combined with bortezomib dex and compared with bortezomib dex in patients who had myeloma relapsing after 1 to 3 prior therapies. On the left, the yellow line shows you that there was a longer time without active myeloma with selinexor bortezomib dex. And on the right-hand side, this benefit was enjoyed by all subsets, age, risk status, frailty, et cetera. A second very important advance that continues to be updated was reported by Shaji Kumar at ASH. For those of you who have 11-14 translocation multiple myeloma, especially, the venetoclax oral therapy combined with bortezomib on the left-hand side of this slide achieves much longer time without active myeloma or progression-free survival compared to bortezomib dex. And on the right-hand side, this is actually overall survival advantage. It's really not significant yet, but you can see that there is a long overall survival being achieved. And also during the pandemic, led preclinically here and clinically by Paul Richardson here, the immunotoxin belantamab mafodotin, which targets BCMA with an antibody and brings an immunotoxin. So it's a two-way kill, immunologic with the antibody and the toxin as a second mechanism of inducing myeloma death. Just have you focus on the left row of 2.5 milligram per kilogram. That's the FDA approved dose. Response rate was about 30%. And in fact, the durability was about 11 months. The issue here is with some keratopathy, which can be associated with visual changes, but these are usually transient. And then excitingly, during the most recent FDA approval involves CAR T cells. I just want to make sure everybody understands what they are. But on the right-hand side of this, there are T cells that are collected from you by leukapheresis. They are genetically activated and transduced to recognize myeloma, most of the time based on BCMA expression on the myeloma surface. They're expanded, as I like to say, to be your own immune army. Then you receive some chemotherapy called lymphocyte depleting treatment. That's just to make room so you can get a transfusion back of what I call your own immune army of these programmed T cells to kill myeloma. And again, we have an FDA approved product. It's called Ide-cel. This trial was led by Dr. Nikhil Munshi at our center. And again, the detail is available for your review, but I will just focus you on the blue and yellow columns and the 450 million column in particular, which shows you a response rate of 81% in far advanced myeloma. And in fact, the durability of this response was on the order of 11 months with future studies trying to not only improve the responses, but also especially the durability of the responses. But very exciting to have the first CAR T cell approved in myeloma. Now I want to finish up my talk with some new and exciting things to try to get you excited about the future as I am. First, I'm going to talk about how to use some of the drugs we already know about, proteasome inhibitors, for the first time to induce an anti-myeloma immune response in you after treatment. What about the stronger lenalidomide and pomalidomides? What about what's called bispecific T-cell engagers? And I'll explain that in a minute. And mention just some preliminary data on why we're so excited about combining these new treatments with treatments we already have. And at the end, what's more futuristic in terms of CAR T cells in particular. This is a particular picture of the proteasome. In the center, I call it my favorite garbage disposal because it's where your body breaks down all proteins, including the myeloma M protein. And we reasoned 20 years ago, if we inhibited this garbage disposal, that your myeloma cells would fill up with its own protein and commit suicide. And that's literally what happens. But we didn't understand until this year that bortezomib or Velcade has a whole nother activity. It's called immunogenic cell death. And so in this picture, you induce the death of a tumor cell, myeloma in our case, and the myeloma cell expresses something on its cell surface when it's dying called calreticulum. It's an eat me signal, and the immune antigen presenting cells are then take this dying myeloma cell up and present it to your immune system with the consequence of generating an anti-myeloma selective response in you. So in other words, bortezomib is not only directly killing by inhibiting the proteasome, but the dying myeloma cells are triggering an immune response. We studied this in detail, in particular, Anna Maria Gula, who is a superstar in our group. And in her mouse models, if these mice manifested immunogenic cell death after bortezomib treatment, there was a certain genetic signature. And we looked in the mice that correlated with very good outcome. And on the right-hand side, that also was true. The red line in the lower right-hand corner, the highest overall survival was in those patients who received bortezomib, not only had direct killing of their cancer cell, but had this immunogenic cell death. And I'll show you how exciting this can be. This is ongoing work by Anna Maria. But in fact, you know that 17p deletion is high-risk myeloma. And Anna has worked this out and presented at the American Society of Hematology in an oral session that in order for the dying myeloma cell to present this protein, this eat me signal called calreticulum on the cell surface, there's another protein, it doesn't matter, but it's called GAPARAP that needs to be there. Sadly, GAPARAP is on chromosome 17p. So high-risk myeloma doesn't have this GAPARAP. It doesn't result, it cannot get this eat me signal to the cell surface of the dying tumor cell, so you don't get immunogenic cell death. Suffice it to say, we're all over trying to understand how to restore immunogenic cell death in patients who have high-risk disease. In other words, or plain English, part of the reason myeloma is high risk in this context of 17p is the lack of immunogenic cell death. And if we can restore it, that would be really important, not only in myeloma, but in many other cancers, including solid tumors, where 17p deletion is also high risk. What about the immunomodulatory drugs? Can we make those better? Well, this is a complicated cartoon, but the IMIDs, thalidomide, lenalidomide, pomalidomide, all bind to something called cereblon complex. And that, instead of blocking degradation of proteins, it turns on the degradation of proteins called IKZF1 and 3. Honestly, the details are not important, but on the left-hand side of this slide, the new stronger immunomodulatory drugs are called CELMoDs. CC220 was reported at ASH to have a 26% response rate, even when lenalidomide and pomalidomide didn't work. And Paul Richardson from our group, as you know, has combined a stronger immunomodulatory or a CELMoD 92480 and with bortezomib dex and achieved higher response rate, 73%, in the context of some patients who have been treated previously with pomalidomide as shown. So the future is using bortezomib and drugs like it for immunologic purposes. It'd be a good partner for immune treatments. And then there are these stronger cell mods that are coming along that look very promising. Now, bispecific T-cell engagers are my favorites, to be honest with you. What are they? They are off-the-shelf medicines that were given initially by vein and now subcutaneously. They go into your blood or they bind, and there they bind to CD3, which is a marker on T cells, and another marker, BCMA or otherwise, on the tumor. So suffice it to say, on the right-hand side of this slide, as you can see, you bring your own immune cells to the tumor cells exactly where you want them to get more activity and fewer side effects. At ASH this year, teclistamab is the first one. It's the furthest along in development, was presented by J&J. And in particular, what was this? They did dose response studies initially, escalating the dose. And what was reported at ASH wasn't shown on this slide, that in patients with far refractory multiple myeloma, 62% of patients had an overall response that was quite durable, and these studies are ongoing. Now, BCMA is not the only target for BiTEs or CAR T cells for that matter in myeloma. One that was called GPRC5D, developed by Eric Smith now at Dana-Farber, is shown here. This was presented and updated at the American Society of Hematology. And my excitement and reason for including this, it's called talquetamab, is that you wanna be able to have a medicine that's gonna be active even when BCMA is no longer active. So what was the punchline here of this BiTE targeting a new target, GPRC5D. Again, in the middle of this slide, 60 to 70% overall response, even in far advanced disease. So these medicines are very exciting. This is a table you can just keep and look at time to time if you want. but I made a summary and updated all the different BiTEs that are being used, most of them against BCMA, one of them against GPRC5D, and one of them against a different target called FCRH5. Suffice it to say, all of them are getting high response rates, well tolerated, and the durability is still early, so it's hard to say, but they look very promising. Now, these BiTEs are not going to be used in the future by themselves. They're going to be used by combinations like we do other classes of novel agents. This is a study I'll just mention quickly that we did where we combined lenalidomide or pomalidomide with one of the BiTEs. And what it shows on the left is even if you use a low amount of drugs, lenalidomide and pomalidomide, and a low amount of cells, T cells, you can, in a dose-dependent way, kill myeloma cell line on the left, or in an autologous system, patient myeloma cells in a dose-dependent way. So you can use lower doses of drugs, lower doses of the cells, and likely get fewer side effects. And this, in an animal model, works extremely well. On the left-hand side, this is using the BiTE called AMG-701 in different doses. And you can see a dose-dependent response. And on the right is the most exciting one, this green line, which is one the same BiTE in patients who's had human, patients being mice, who had human myeloma growing in them. The green line shows you that the BiTE and lenalidomide can cause a marked decrease in tumor cell growth. So this already translated to the clinic. And I'll just mention one example from the American Society of Hematology, the GPRC5D BiTE was combined with daratumumab. So you have a GPRC5D immune response and you have a CD38 immune response with daratumumab. And what was shown was that the overall response rate was 77 to 85%. And this included people whose myeloma was refractory to daratumumab. So combination therapies are here to stay. BiTEs are a very new member of the combination team. Finally, CAR T cells to finish up. I mentioned already the first one on the left-hand side of this slide, ide-cel, that's FDA approved. I'll remind you that the response rate at the dose of 450 million was 81% and it lasted approximately 11 months. The new one, excuse me, that was presented at ASH and likely to be FDA approved soon is called cilta-cel. It targets BCMA and almost everybody responds and the durability is quite long. Here it's called the CARTITUDE 1 study. It's been reported previously, but what's different about this one is the CAR T cells are programmed against BCMA, but they bind BCMA on the myeloma cell at two distinct sites. So the binding affinity is increased. At ASH, what was presented is 98% of people responded to this CAR T cell, even with far advanced disease. And the duration of response was not reached even as long as 22 months. So we're starting to see some durability. Here's the summary. The two-year time without myeloma and overall survival rates were 60.5 and 74%. And this is in the context of far advanced myeloma. So these agents are looking very promising and are moving earlier into the disease course where they should work even better still. Now, one of the problems we've noticed, and this is a patient from Dana-Farber that we treated, that I was treating, was these agents can be very exciting, but new resistance mechanisms can also develop. So this is an example on the left of a patient who had far advanced myeloma and got a BCMA-related treatment. And the blue shows the M protein went down and the green shows the lambda free light chain went down. Unfortunately, the myeloma returned and she got another BCMA CAR T cell. But the problem was in the red line on the right, that at the time of her second infusion, her myeloma did not express BCMA anymore. We actually showed that the gene for BCMA was deleted. So this suggests that we probably need to do something more clever with CAR T cells to overcome these potential resistance, such as maybe targeting more than one antigen at the same time. The final concept I want to leave you with is this. We have what's called a bat CAR. Many of you are old enough to remember Robin and Batman. And on the left-hand side is a traditional CAR, but on the right-hand side is what I want to talk to you about. The plain and simple explanation is you could use an antibody against myeloma, such as daratumumab or isatuximab or elotuzumab, and that antibody would be linked to, say, protein X. So if once you get that antibody, all your myeloma is labeled with X. Then you give a small number of CAR T cells that are activated, but they're only going to get activated when they bind to X. So this is a way of bringing the CAR T cells right where you want them, hopefully in so doing, increasing potency and avoiding toxicity. And why is this important? You can use low amounts of antibody, low amounts of CAR T cells. You can target more than one antigen at the same time. And I mentioned a minute ago, we hope by doing that, you can overcome resistance. Here's a couple of experiments. And the point is the red bar is daratumumab, which many of you know, CD38 antibody. With the bat CAR, it works extremely well. Low amounts of daratumumab, low amounts of cells for a short incubation, very active. The orange here is idacel. That's the FDA-approved CAR T cell. And the bat CAR is the green on the right. So we're excited that this concept is killing in the same range as what is already being done with FDA-approved products. The other concept I want to mention before closing is that we've learned during this pandemic that the world is not fair. We know that not all patients have access to all advances. It turns out, and I'll just use this one example, that myeloma is more common in African Americans, but they haven't shared in the benefits of novel treatments. What we and others have shown is when African Americans are able to receive novel therapies, they do as well or better than anybody else. Sadly, COVID-19 has highlighted this disparity in healthcare access and patient outcome. So we've working together with the AACR, American Association of Cancer Research, and the FDA, why we want to overcome this disparity. We want to have clinical trials that have planned enrollment of minorities, and we want to have real-world patients, patients who don't have to have normal everything in order to get on a clinical trial, but might be able to have renal compromise or diabetes or some history of hypertension. That way, if we call real-world patients to our clinical trials, when the new agents get approved, we will know the true efficacy and side effects in real-world patients as we treat. So here's the summary and conclusions. CD38 antibody is now being included in newly diagnosed disease management, RVD-DARA in the transplant candidates or RD-DARA in the non-transplant candidates. Stem cell transplant is still the standard of care. It achieves high rates of MRD negativity, more time without active myeloma, and overall survival. So it's a standard of care. I mentioned and showed you the menu. We have a lot of different choices if myeloma relapses. We usually use three drugs together for relapsed disease treatment. And I mentioned some of the new exciting things, the BCMA-directed immunotoxin, the BiTEs, and the CAR T cells. So here's my last slide. I believe in the future, we'll already be using combinations, RVD daratumumab, for example. And why will we be using those routinely? Because of the high minimal residual disease negativity rates. At that point where we're now using stem cell transplant, likely we will then compare stem cell transplant with bispecific T cell engagers or CAR T cells. And the goal here will be to get high rates of MRD negativity, but also to generate in patients an immune response that remembers their myeloma. I also think, as I told you, we'll be using agents in new ways. So we'll be inhibiting the proteasome cascade and trying to induce immunity, for example. And I showed you already that combinations of new agents, so the bispecific T cell engagers with lenalidomide or pomalidomide or with daratumumab. I mentioned new targets such as GPRC5D, and I mentioned one of my favorites, bad cars. That, by the way, is also emanating from Dana-Farber. Punchline is at the bottom here in red. It is my hope and expectation that long-term disease-free survival and potential cure of myeloma can be achieved with combinations of targeted and immune treatments. Why? To achieve both MRD negativity and, importantly, to restore host memory anti-myeloma immunity. If we can do those things together, then patients will be able to be not only free of disease, but off all therapy. So I thank you for this opportunity and hope you can all stay very well and, importantly, safe with your families. Thanks so much.